Okay, hi everyone. So the book I'm going to talk about today is Ways of Seeing by John Berger. This book was actually a BBC television series which came out in the 1970s, and it was then later converted into a book. So I think before I talk about what happens in the book, I think we should dwell a little on the socio-historical background. I think whenever you analyze a piece of work, it is very important because the background gets reflected in the piece of work. So a little on the background. So if we divide all of the centuries into various periods of thought, in the 19th century, there was a thought process called romanticization, where everything was romanticized. There was a lot of focus on emotions and less more on scientific rationality. So in the first decade of the 20th century, there was a major transition from romanticization to modernism. Modernism, to put it very simply, is basically a non-aestheticized depiction of reality. So if I see poverty on the streets of Mumbai, I'm going to make a piece of art on it. And that is a modernist piece of art. So there were various art movements in the modernism, and one of them was surrealism. Surrealism is basically random abstract images which allow the unconscious to reflect itself. So the 20th century, because of the World War, was also a period when there was a lot of advancements in psychology. So Sigmund Freud, who is also called the father of psychoanalysis, in his work, he focused on the relationship between the conscious and the unconscious mind. So surrealism came into place. So this book is actually based on a painting, a surrealist painting called The Key of Dreams by Margaret. And this painting came out in 1930. So this painting basically focuses on the relationship between words and images. So from childhood, we are taught words on the basis of the images. So if I show a child a picture of this, I'm going to tell that it's a phone. So there's a relationship between words and images. So what Margaret does in the painting is that there is no association between the words and the images. So if there is a painting of this, this is not a phone, this is a horse. So what he does is that if I just give you the image and if I don't give you the word for it, it allows your mind, especially it allows your subconscious mind, to come up with its own interpretation. And there is a term for it which is called free association. So it is basically a metaphorical thinking, and it is an expression of the unconscious mind. So this book, I think the title is very self-explanatory. It is basically the way we see and the way we allow our unconscious mind to take over when we look at things. To simply define the book in one line, we explain the world with words, but words can never undo the fact that we are surrounded by it. So there is always going to be a gap between words and images which we can never fulfill. So this book has basically four chapters. The first one is images. So I think we live in a very visual world where you're constantly surrounded by images. And we see images with vision. And when it comes to vision, there are two aspects of it. The first one is the pre-association with it. Suppose, for example, if I was bitten by a dog in my childhood, whenever I see a dog now, I'm going to be filled with fear. So that is pre-association with it. And the second is there is a reciprocal nature of vision. If I am seeing you, you are seeing me as well. So images were first produced to fill up the absence of something. Because people were so obsessed with preserving people and of age. And this is where images turned into paintings. So paintings, earlier, I think the last century, there was a whole unique experience of going into an exhibition and seeing a painting. The entire process was an experience in itself. But then came camera. And what camera did was it led into mass production of images. So even though paintings were something which was only limited to the elite section earlier, because of camera, there was a lot of accessibility to it. So suppose for now, if I want to see a painting of Mona Lisa, I won't go to a museum in Paris and see it. I will just search it up and find a picture of it. But even though it increased the accessibility of it, what it did was it took away the uniqueness of it. So now paintings don't have meanings. It is just, so earlier there was a uniqueness of original, but now it is just the original of reproduction. So there's been a huge transition in it. This is also where the commodification of paintings came into place. Earlier paintings, so now the market price of a painting is based on how distant it is from the common people. So the second chapter is gender. And herein, I would like to touch upon the differences between the male and the female. So apart from the obvious differences which we know, there is also a major difference in how we view these two genders. So this, since we're talking about the difference between being portrayed, this is a question which I would like all of the females in the audience to think about. So whenever, when you step into a crowded place, what I feel, I have a feeling of being seen. Whenever I step into a crowded local train and there is a grill separating the ladies' compartment from the male compartment, I can see the male gaze. So this is something which I would like to you to think about. So this is where the portrayal of gender comes into place. So in media, the male is being portrayed as a surveyor and the female is a surveyed. So there's a quote, so men look at women, women watch themselves being looked at. I think this is something which we can see in everyday life. So to give an example, suppose a woman is being eve teased. I think this is a very classic example. She is being seen and she knows that she is being seen and yet she can't do anything about it. And sometimes she feels guilty about it. So she is being made to feel modest about the fact that she is being seen. So apart from males being surveyor, there is also a surveyor within the female. So another quote is, a man's presence is dependent upon the promise of the power he embodies, while a woman's presence expresses her own attitude to herself. So to give an example, if you see any advertisement, suppose if a deodorant or a perfume advertisement, so there will be a male hero, which is very masculine, very macho, and he embodies power. He becomes the product itself. Whereas the female, which she will be beside him, and she will know her place, which is just an accompaniment to him. She is being there just to fill up the space beside him. She does not embody power at all. So I think two main concepts in this would be naked and nudity. We have heard these terms a lot and we often interchange them. There's a clear difference between the two, and this was given by Kenneth Clark in his work The Nude. So the naked is to be without clothes, but nudity is to be naked and yet not be seen for oneself. I think this is true for a lot of female depictions in media. So a naked object has to be seen as an object in order to become nude. I think there's a very clear difference between the two. And earlier, even in paintings, the women were seen as naked. The women were naked. But now, in today's media, they're being viewed as nude. So if you take Bollywood, for example, especially item songs. So most of, I think all female characters are being turned into nude. And their sexuality is being put up for sale. So in a way, their sexual passion is minimized. And in a way, this becomes a reminder for the male audience and the male hero itself that they are men, that they have the power. They can do anything they want. So the ideal spectator is always assumed to be male. And the image of woman is designed to flatter him. So to give a cross-reference, in the Brave New World yesterday, which we talked about, the body is made to be utilized by everyone. And I think Bollywood is a very classic example of that. The third part which I would like to talk about is property. So ownership was, with the rise of capitalism and consumerism, especially since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, oil paintings were usually seen as a means to depict the everyday items. So normal paintings would usually depict scenes from mythology, Greek mythology, or any such epic. But what oil paintings did was, they depicted what the patrons were people who hired artists to paint for them. So what they did was, they could depict objects which they could buy. So it was a reminder for them that they have the property, they have the ownership. So what oil painting did to appearances was what capital did to social relations. It also led to a commodification of everything in the room. So this is also where the representation of class came into picture. So the people, very often objects were depicted in oil paintings, but when people were depicted, their gaze or their position was designed as if they were distant from the other people. So if there is a portrait of a family, of a bourgeois, is basically elite family, so if there is a oil painting of them, whenever people would look at them, they would know that we can consider them with interest, but they do not consider ourselves as of any interest. So this was very common in the paintings of during the colonialism period. The African Americans were seen kneeling in front of the Europeans. And this was what I think divided the differences between them on basis of race as well as position and class. Whenever there is property, so a lot of oil paintings had depicted estates of the lords back in the 18th century. So what they did was they used private land in a form of philosophic enjoyment. So what we studied yesterday in the ladder, they used material goods to achieve psychological satisfaction. So the fourth part is what I like the most about this book. It talks about publicity. And this is what we discussed about yesterday as well. So I think this is the age of advertisements and PR. And whenever we look at a billboard, we know what it is there for. But we are not completely aware of the power it has on us. So what the advertisements and images do is that they make us dissatisfied with our present selves. So in a way, they offer us a picture of the future. They offer us our future as a sale. So when you're being presented with a lot of choices, with a lot of consumerism and goods, they give you the power of being enviable. So the state of being envied is what constitutes glamour. And publicity is a process of manufacturing it. Also, being envied is a solitary form of free assurance. You are observed with interest, but you do not observe them with interest. So in a way, this maximizes the disparity between the haves and the have-nots. And another concept here is the power of money. This is also what we talked yesterday as well. So what money, yes, it has power, but what it also does is through these billboards advertisement, it works on the anxiety of people. So if I have filthy rich money, I'll be anxious on how to earn more. But even if I don't have money, I'll have the fear that I'm nothing. So the power to spend money is associated with the power to live, and those who do not have it are basically represented as those faceless. They do not have an identity of their own. It is also, we can also compare it with sexuality. So the ability to buy things is also equal to the ability to being sexually desirable. This is what the media does through consumerism and advertisements and Bollywood. So the gap between what publicity offers and the future it promises corresponds with the fact between what the spectator feels for himself and what he would like to be. So I think the last part of the book talks about on how herein the government works with the industries. And I think we touched upon this as well here yesterday, but when we are presented with a lot of options, the government is indirectly trying to shield us from the real problems. So if I in Mumbai is given a lot of opportunities, I won't take notice of what is happening in Northeast India. This is a very planned strategy. And it is also a compensation in a way for all that is undemocratic in the society. So capitalism survives by forcing the majority to determine their own interests as narrowly as possible, through imposing a false standard of what is and what is not desirable. So to sum it up all, that publicity has become the life of the culture nowadays. And this has taken over every aspect of our life. And this is something I think which we all should think about. Thank you.